I'm not exactly an expert on hymns and music. Being deprived of musical ability from an early age. But I have, in the course of studying spiritual things, I've grown to appreciate songs of many faiths and many nations. And it always amazes me when we have a piece of scripture like Psalm 98, which is about 2,500 years old. Can you imagine that? The words of the sons of some ancient person who created that song of praise to God was expressing something that's so deep in the human heart that it exists that many years later. I one time picked up a sparse collection of Native American songs that dated back perhaps 1,000 years. So it's amazing that Psalm 98 has endured the ages. It has to do with its sentiments, I think, and it was good to hear you read it, because the further we got into it, you began to say it joyfully. You began to get into the spirit of the hymn. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. It talks about the music of the spheres, and isn't it true that nature has its own music? When I was up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan this last summer, I learned that bears purr. You ever heard a bear purr? They purr. I have a video of it. I'll show it to you if you ask me sometimes. All of the animals have their own songs, don't they? They make their own noises. Sing to God a new song. Make a joyful noise to all the earth. Great words. Amazing words when you consider the times that they were written in. A time of captivity, a time of want, a time of uncertainty. Perhaps I think that we could compare this psalm to maybe "We Shall Overcome." It was a song of people who did not have all of the good things in life that we enjoy today. Psalm 98 encourages us to use all of our lives for God, to be all in. People at Trinity generally don't like new songs. We found that out. It's very difficult to sing a new song, isn't it? It's even difficult when we slightly change the words to old songs, even though we know the tune. But how hard is it for us to sing a new song? As a nation, we're struggling with singing a new song today. As people who look out at the world and we wonder what's happening, it's hard for us to find a tune, to find a new song to sing. Have you ever wondered why people sing at all? Well, one thing that I found out is that there never has existed a culture on this earth that did not sing. And in fact, in a book on the origins of song and music, it says, it has a line that says, "No songless people have ever been discovered." Isn't that amazing? Charles Darwin thought that it originated when we were babies. And a baby had to know the sound of its mother's voice in order to survive. And so those songs that were sung were deeply ingrained in the baby's mind so that they were safe throughout their lives. There's something about safety in songs, isn't there? Songs that are instinctive. We have music therapy today in our nursing homes, and we participate in a program whereby people are given musical lists of their favorite songs, and it stimulates certain parts deeply hidden in the brain that activate our memories. All of us have witnessed at some point or another someone who can't speak at all, but when they hear "Silent Night" or "Joy to the World" during Christmas carol singing, they're right there and they know every word. It's a deep part of our brain. I know many people walking around Worcester who have music 24 hours a day because they have we've created our own soundtracks to our lives, right? We walk to the tune of Jimi Hendrix all along the watchtower. Some of you have your own soundtrack because you play the same song over and over again because I've seen you driving and singing. Churches have windows that open because they call them singing windows. So it's not only for the benefit of the people who sing, it's for God and for the people who hear you sing. I always like to think of the Bible as a musical because it's so full of so many different songs that people sang at significant points in their life. We remember Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz, right? Somewhere Over the Rainbow expresses both our hopes and our fears, some of the deep things of our soul. Do you remember why the Grinch was transformed? He heard the singing of the Who around the pole, and his heart grew and grew and grew because he heard the singing of others. And It's a Wonderful Life. He got his wings when the bell rang. You remember that story where they're all gathered together? Pay attention to when you see song in a movie because it's very important. This past Friday, and we have flowers here from the memorial service for Don Wagner. And at the end of that memorial service, we sang For All the Saints, number 299 in the hymnal. And the reason why I know that is because that was Glenn Royer's favorite song. And if we didn't have it in the memorial service, when we walked out, I know he would always tap me on the shoulder and he would say, "Why didn't we sing For All the Saints?" And when the strife is fierce and the warfare long steals on the ear the distant triumph song, then hearts are brave again and faith grows strong. Those are the last words of that hymn. Well, there comes a time in our lives when everyone needs to sing a new song. We need a new opening. And I want you to consider today what new song you need to sing. A new attitude. A new spirit. A new expression. Sometimes in our prayers we don't take full advantage of them because prayer is a time for us to call to mindfulness. To think about all of the wonderful things in this world and all of the things that God has given to us. And generosity has always been at the heart of singing. Thanksgiving services are always at the heart of the people of Israel. They talk about the rain and the sun and providence and care and angels and protectors and the Spirit. Paul was the same way. Generosity was one of the ways he could tell that the Spirit was in people. Jesus said it's better to give than to receive. We all feel better about giving, about being productive, than about receiving. And I can't tell you this last week how many people called me or emailed or Facebooked or came into the office to talk to me about the changes that are happening in America and what can be done about that. And I do believe that the things that can be done about America today are the things that we've been doing for 2,000 years when we've lived in a world where most systems dominate people, where most systems live with economic inequality, is for us to do those solid things. To pray for people, to sing for people, to clothe the naked, to feed the hungry, to do the work that Jesus called us to do, in season and out of season. And after we've seen this election year, where all this from, we're often all separated, and sometimes even divided. Sometimes there are hostilities, and some people have come to talk to me about those things as well. But as the Bible says, this week we have Psalm 98, and it offers us an alternative. And that alternative in Psalm 98 says, don't go there. Whatever our cultural diagnosis, be, whatever the sociological trends are, and however deeply Wall Street tanks, whatever the opinion polls say, and we all know they're wrong, do not yield to despair. Do not give up. Instead, choose the most radical thing that you can ever do in life, to love your enemies. The most radical political option that we have today is a subversive song of genuine joy, because we know who holds the universe. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Whoever it was that wrote that 2,500 years ago today certainly needed to sing those songs and to lift them up. And to live joyfully is the greatest honor that we can give to God. And that's what we're doing here today. Gratefully and generously, continuing to do the things that make a difference. 86% of Americans who voluntarily cut back their consumption feel happier when they do. And only 9% of people, if they're asked to cut back on their consumption, say they're less happy. Is another tax break really the good news today? Are the promises of a politician the good news that our lives depend upon? It's hard for us to see the kingdom of God. And I'm not happy when I see families with special needs children who lose their benefits. Those parents who worry about what might happen to their children when they're no longer able to care for them. I'm not happy when I talk to people who stop taking life-saving medications because they can't afford them. I'm not happy when I see all of our friends in the breakfast program die of preventable diseases because they couldn't get the care they needed. Where people give up hope and turn to a variety of addictions, that's not a good world. What would really make me happy is to live in a country where I know that people will take care of one another. And we should never turn things down in the life of our church. An opportunity that we have, because I know that someone needs it, and some people need it pretty desperately. So in the midst of all these worldly uncertainties, we have to stick to building a trustworthy community that attends to the business that Jesus set us about. Feed the hungry, clothe the naked, comfort the afflicted. I can give myself to that. And I want to live in a community where people have goodwill towards one another. People who are willing to build up instead of tear down. And what faith is when you live it is goodwill and trust in God and the future. Got a wedding here yesterday. Some of you may remember Pamela Miller was our secretary here for a number of years. Some of you might be shocked to know that was 9 years ago. She left here. Time goes fast. Great wedding. Very happy for the couple. They found one another after being at the College of Worcester together. And I'm almost struck when we have those wedding vows. There's a line in that that says, I give myself to you to be your husband. I give myself to you to be your wife. And real love is giving ourselves with our heart, with our vision, first in my heart. There was a song that was sung at the National Youth Event a couple of years ago. It was one of the songs that stuck with our youth, and they even brought it back, and we used it often for communion. And the theme of that song was, I give myself away so you can use me as you come to the communion table. Do you ever say that prayer to God? I give myself to you. I give myself to you so you can use me. Maybe during our silent prayer time, as we're coming forward with our gifts and with our pledges, you can dedicate yourself to God and to say, in all the uncertainties and unknowns in this life, I give myself to you so that you can use me. Amen.